baby, what's the reason I get the go-by? Like to know why, long time no see. Long time adore, if you're on the level, why don't you tell me why me no see you anymore? Let him go, let him go, everyone keeps telling me.
All right, so I'm apparently live. Chris is signing on to Skype right now. So while he's doing that, I'm going to explain just a little bit of Spy Party for those that don't know what it is. Spy Party is an upcoming indie multiplayer competitive espionage game of a spy versus a sniper. The spy needs to complete some objectives. He's in a party, and he needs to blend in with about 15 or so AIs and act like an AI to get away with his missions. Meanwhile, a player plays the sniper and tries to figure out who the human is, who the spy is, and shoot that person with their one bullet. It's very, very fun. So let me just give Chris a call and see how it goes. Hello?
Hello.
Hey, how's it going?
Good. Sorry. I'm so, so sorry.
It's okay. Yeah, I mean, we're just very grateful to have you as a guest on stream. Oh.
You're not actually in my ear. Hold on a second. I forgot to plug my thing in.
Okay.
There. Is that better?
Yeah. Sounds really good.
Okay. Let me continue to get a clue here for a second. Okay.
It's okay. That was a very long bathroom break. We'll put it that way.
Yeah, it was like... I may have done more testing during the break.
It's okay. I'm sure you have a laptop in the bathroom set up for situations like that.
Yeah, exactly. All right. Okay. What the hell am I doing?
All right, let me try to turn you up just a little bit, because apparently you're a little bit quiet, or I can turn myself down. Let's do that a little bit, actually. There we go.
Okay, let me get this working here.
So for those that don't know who our guest is tonight, we have on stream Chris Hecker, who is the developer on the upcoming indie game Spy Party, highly anticipated. And he was one of the lead guys on the character creation aspects in Spore, correct?
Yes.
Now, we did our whole... this is actually Chris's second time on stream, so welcome back to Vine Sauce.
Oh, thank you very much for having me, and I'm so sorry it's so late.
It's okay. So we did our whole Spore chat last time, so we're going to stay away from Spore and just focus totally on Spy Party.
Okay.
And the big topic that I want to hit tonight... I mean, we can talk about anything, of course... But the big topic that I want to hit is communities.
Communities, awesome. I like that.
Because I mean, there's been a lot of talk, even just from other media, because with open beta having just hit, you guys on the stream who are watching this have never seen this before, you can buy this game right now.
It's yes, very fun. Which is brand new thing free.
So the open beta is totally done, totally out. So now...
Done is maybe the wrong word.
yeah, exactly. The out. It's out. Open beta is available. So that obviously brought up some concerns with the community, and it just, I think everyone kind of turned their attention to how that would impact the community.
Yeah, myself included. I mean, there were long periods. I think that actually part of the delay in getting the open beta open was the terror about what would happen to the awesome community. And as we've seen, like, thank goodness, it's like actually turned out really, really great. But yeah, it was kind of terrifying to start out with. It's like, you know, just don't. I mean, there are so many bad communities on internet games, on games that are on the internet.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, famous examples, but like, it's just, yeah, it's like, I mean, especially with a game this weird and different from existing games, and so mentoring is so important.
Yeah.
The quality of the community is so important just because the game is so raw right now and such the harsh skill curve,
mm-hmm.
that it's really important for people to chat and talk and feel comfortable. And then there's just the additional aspect of, you know, just wanting it to be a place that's like, you know, I mean, I put a lot of love in this game and I don't want it to be, you know, kind of taken over.
You don't want it to be a shit fest, to put it.
Yeah, bluntly. I mean, like to put it bluntly. Yeah, you want it to be like, you know, your living room. You have some people over, and you you know, people you like, and it's cool, and that's great. And now there's more people here that could be in my living room right now.
Right.
But hopefully that kind of attitude kind of carries through. Plus, there's the aspect of diversity and stuff that we could probably talk about. That like the Kotaku thing and the forum post that I posted on the blog talked about, which is just this idea of like there are so few safe places on the internet for people who are, you know, somewhat different than the average game player, you know, like trans people or gay people or women in general or all kinds of different, you know, diverse, you know, subset sections of humanity that may not be really well represented in gaming.
Absolutely.
And you know those people, like those people, can be just as awesome at Spy Party as anybody else. And so I want them to feel
or
like,
any game. But I mean, yeah. But you want to make it clear, I guess, in our in the community that I guess that is a, such a thing. I mean, and with how polite we are to each other and how accepting we are of each other, and of course that's also reflected just in the avatars of the game. But
right, yeah. So it's like I kind of when I was working on that post in the interview with Kotaku, like there was like kind of five different kinds of diversity. I mean, it's kind of silly to like enumerate them, but like there's the in-game diversity, like what you just said. You know, there's mm-hmm. going to be. I want this game to be, you know, from an in-game fictional perspective, like the most diverse game ever. Like, I mean, you know, playable characters who are black, white, all different races, all different ages, genders, ability, meaning people in a wheelchair. There's going to be like people with canes, you know, all kinds of different things. So not your typical, like, you know, strapping James Bond guy and the, you know, like 20-something women. It's going to be a very diverse crowd. And you can see a little bit of that in the art right now that's in the crappy art that's in. Mm-hmm. You can see a hint of it in the art that's, you know, that we released.
Yeah, like, hang on. I actually have a couple of those pictures, like the animation stills. Let me find one. Like, this is the
the
Morgan Freeman-style character who has a cane. And this actually kind of brings up one of my favorite parts about this design is that, one, it's a double win, because, one, it's going to be one of the most diverse games ever in terms of character selection. But on the other hand, that also reflects very nicely from a gameplay perspective, because like if you have a character that's in a wheelchair, obviously that will be the more tempting pick for a spy since they'll be really low. But if the sniper knows that, then they'll just highlight that wheelchair character. So
right, there's all kinds of yomi associated with almost everything. I mean, in some sense, the game is within parameters is kind of self-balancing in that sense, because anything that looks like a spy buff makes that person more suspicious.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
You can't count on that to totally balance the game, but it helps a lot.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that kind of diversity, that should be in basically any game where it's practical. But I like how, in say like Mass Effect or something, you can pick male, you can pick female. It changes some dialogue stuff, but it doesn't reflect on the gameplay. Whereas with Spy Party, it's going to reflect on gameplay and the metagame in a huge positive way, and I love that
right.
too.
Totally.
So, I mean, how's the whole diversity side? When it comes to the community of the game, I guess a lot of ways it's likened to, I mean, the dynamics with player interaction, it's kind of likened to MOBAs, League of Legends, or especially fighting games too, since it's a one-on-one type dynamic in-game.
Right.
And I love that. So, I guess one of the things I want to talk about is, I guess you've been spending a lot of time influencing the community directly yourself. Like I came into the lobby for the first time, you greeted everyone. It makes it very clear that, I guess you make it very clear that we're here to help each other and not to win. I guess.
Yeah, I mean, I'm totally fine with people coming to win, but that doesn't mean you can't help people and, you know, be polite. Like, there's no, you could be the best Spy Party player in the world, but just there's no reason not to be polite to people. I mean,
yeah.
Why wouldn't be? And if you lose, like, hey, learn something from it. There's no, you know, the rudeness thing that happens that comes from, you know, the whole, you know, to use the Penny Arcade version of it, the greater internet fuckwad theorem of, like, you know, anonymity in an audience and things like that. Like, the rudeness thing is just totally orthogonal to skill at a game. Like, I mean, I want Spy Party to be the one of the most intense player skill games ever. I want it to be on par with, like, what you said, like, you know, fighting games and mm-hmm. and the highest end, you know, Counter-Strike, highest end shooters and the highest end RTSs and stuff like that. I mean, a different mix of micro and macro from all those games, you know, it's a different game. But
right.
at the same time, there's nothing inherent in the play of those games that that requires rudeness, you know, like there's certain dynamics that happen. I think SpyParty is lucky because the design kind of, it's a little bit of a mature design in the sense that it's kind of an intimate, kind of very slow paced kind of thing. Whereas, you know, some of the more frenetic games, like kind of, you know, that play more on testosterone as opposed to tension.
Yeah, I was going to bring that up myself. I was going to say that, like, part of it is you influencing the community, which is very important. But part of it's also just the feel and the design of the game. It's a very non-violent game. I mean, other than that one bullet.
Yeah, totally. I can't remember if we talked about this last time, but like, it's actually a kind of a filmic use of violence. Like, there's actually no violence in the interactivity of the game at all. Like, at the point where the sniper pulls the trigger, like, the game's over. Like, it's not even an interactive violence in that sense. Like,
yeah.
And so it's kind of like more Hitchcockian in that sense. The thing that makes the game tense is that there's this threat of violence, not the actual violence. Because once you have the violence, like, it's no longer tense. In fact, the shot is a relief for both players. Whether you're alive or dead as the spy, you're like, whew, that's over, you know?
Right, totally. I mean, the only thing, like, the closest thing resembling, I guess, active, I don't want to say violence, but aggression in the game would just be, like, laser pressure on the sniper's end. I mean, and that's grasping at straws, really, but that's the closest thing resembling, I guess, like, a negativity, like a kind of aggression toward the other player. And even still, you know, the spy plays sniper too, most of the time at least, so they understand why that's necessary.
Right, totally. And I mean, it's an interesting part of the, like, you know, they call it laser burning in the community, where you just put your laser on somebody just to see what happens. And yeah, you can. That's a little bit of a dick move in some sense, but it also is like there's nothing, like, they don't. Most of the time, when the spy thinks that the sniper knows who they are, they don't. Right? I mean, it happens on streams all the time, even in elite streams.
Yeah.
The person's like, oh man, I totally have a highlight for that, and like the other guy has no idea. Right?
Or a low light, and, if you're lucky.
Yeah. 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 It's completely. That happens all the time as well. And so, you know, the laser burn as a test thing, I agree, that's kind of like the most actively aggressive thing in the game. And even so, it's more just a shot in the dark in some sense. I mean, if you've got an elite player playing a beginning player and they laser burn them, like, that's just kind of rude. And like, I would hope people wouldn't do that. I mean, that leads to rage quits and people who don't, you know, you want people to play the game, right? Like, you want more people in the community. But in more peer games, you know, after a certain, you know, after through the beginning phase, or even in the beginning, you see people on stream who are learning to play the game and they laser burn each other all the time and think it's hilarious, you know. It's more just when there's a skill differential and someone's showing off, but there are very few ways of doing that. I mean, you get a couple of things, like adding a bunch of time or
I like the clank.
So
I like
slow.
The last second clank right before you win. That's my personal like
KCM
dick move victory taunt. Yeah.
Exactly. But, I mean, like you said, those are so mellow compared to a teabagging or something that's really actively aggressive.
Right, absolutely. So I guess one more question, and then we should probably just play a couple rounds. Like, I'm trying to keep this interview a little bit shorter than the last one.
Especially since I'm 2 hours late showing
up.
Yeah,
but I mean, that I didn't care about. Just the last one was so long. This one I want to try to keep under 90 minutes. That's my goal.
Okay.
We'll see how
cool.
We do. But yes. I wanted to ask, what would you suggest for other game designers who are creating competitive multiplayer games? What can they do? What can they put in their game design, or even like their UI design, their lobby design? What can they do, I guess, to facilitate a healthy, I don't want to say nice, but like a healthy, proactive community that really tries to help each other out, like SpyParty has?
Well, obviously, the uglier your UI in the lobby is, the better your community is. I mean, that's clear from my game.
I'll show that off right now, actually.
I think the kind of games I push for, I think are probably going to all have, I mean, first off, the answer to that is I don't know, because this is all still an experiment. Like, so let's see when there's thousands of people every night playing, let's see how the community is. Like, hopefully, I mean, my goal is to grow it slow. People ask all the time, why aren't you on Steam yet? And I don't want the player numbers yet from Steam. I don't think the community can handle it. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like when you have a startup company, there's this truism that, you're supposed to hire slowly. If you hire more people than you actually have in the company, the culture of the company changes. It spins out of your control, right? I mean, it might change for the better, but like oftentimes, you know, you've got a culture and you want to preserve that. You need to hire slowly because, you know, the new people need to come in. And so the way that I'm doing the open beta, it, you know, kind of supports that. So that kind of very slow growth, so keeping your burn rate low so that a slow growth thing like that can actually be sustainable.
Right, you can actually manage it while it's small and actually have a significant influence on that small bit, and then just they can take it from there as it gets bigger, I guess.
Right, totally, and then, exactly, and then as the community, I mean, you see this now, like, I log on and people are greeting other people, right, and that's just awesome. That's because of the example set, and, like, you know, people are now setting examples to to the other new players, and now I've got this whole mid-range of players. And they're doing it too, and so it's great. I mean, it really is like you set this example and set the tone, and it kind of self-perpetuates. I think that being involved and starting small and growing slowly is a huge thing. I think, again, the game design, the kinds of games that I think the game industry needs, like, I'm not trying to get rid of shooters or RTSs or anything like that, but we have a lot of games exploring in those directions. We want more games exploring in the kind of what I would call like the kind of psychological, behavioral, human element, and I think games like that are going to be, you know, without as much violence, not because I think I have any problem with violence, but just because, hey man, we really, you know, we've got a lot of data.
I guess because so many companies and development teams will misuse the words new or original. They'll say, check out this brand new game, and it's just another shooter. I guess people need to start to, I guess, take the word new more literally.
Well, I tweeted about that the other day because the E3 Critics Awards came out.
Oh, Titanfall, right?
Titanfall won most innovative game or something. I can't remember what it was. It was like, you know, they won like best of show and stuff, and that's fine. Maybe it was the best in show. I don't know. But like, it was like most innovative, and it was like, really? And I saw a quote from those guys, and I'm not trying to beat up on those guys because it's just kind of rife throughout the industry, and that's kind of what my rant at GDC was about. But this idea that like, it's just these small little deltas. Like, there was some quote from those guys. I don't know if it was the Titanfall guys or it was Bungie or somebody who had done some shooters under a big license, you know, and then was doing a new shooter that was not under a big license yet. Mm-hmm. And they were like, finally, we can really stretch our wings because we're not, you know, being held down by this giant license. And like, the game was just another shooter, right? I mean, maybe it's an awesome shooter, and I love shooters. Like, Counter-Strike's one of my favorite games ever, but like, Jesus, come on. Like, a sense of like, these words have meaning if we don't stick to them, you know?
Yeah, and,
like,
and we're just changing the meaning in the wrong way in a lot of ways. But so that's, I guess, the side from your influence. What about, I mean, when I guess see you balancing and managing a community, a big chunk of, or not effort, but a lot of deliberation was put into the statistics that you decide are available to the player and what's not available. Do you think that those have had influence on how the community has turned out, like the fact that you only show the wins? Or...
Right, I think so. I mean, that actually was based on both experience from talking to friends like at Riot and, you know, Blizzard and other companies that have big competitive multiplayer games, and a lot of community feedback early on in the beta. You know, all the really original people, like people, you know, someone would come in new and they were, hey, where's my KD ratio? And I'm like, well, you know, it just turns out that people don't like numbers that go down, right? It can turn off a lot of people. And so, like, that's one of the reasons, like, LOL, in the early days, I'm not sure exactly what they do now, but, like, it just has levels until you, like, kind of earn your ranking system. And then once they know that you're comfortable with the fact that, you know, numbers go up and down and it doesn't mean, you know, it's not worth quitting the game over, then you can see your real rank. But, like, and so, like, our ranking system right now is, since there's not a real ranking system in yet, a skill-based ranking system, it's based on, you know, number of games played and amount of time played. And that kind of correlates really well because the game has such a high skill ramp and we haven't really figured out the skill ceiling yet. Mm-hmm. That does correlate really well with skill. So it's an okay approximation, but it also means that people aren't, you know, losing ladder ranking because, you know, they're not afraid to play people, you know? And in fact, we want to do things like have mentor modes so those don't go into stats and things like that. But having things like just the idea, and that's not intuitive, right? The whole idea that, like, oh, you should just have numbers that go up visible unless someone wants to, learn more. That's a totally non-intuitive thing. I wouldn't have thought of that if somebody who was more experienced with competitive multiplayer games hadn't told me.
Yeah, and I mean, and there's even talk on the forums, there's a little bit of talk about simplifying even further, like maybe instead of showing a raw number, but actually just showing like a meter, like five dots.
Come in, I don't know if you're showing the lobby right now, I'm showing the lobby on my stream, and like, you know, there's some quadruple digit people here, and it's like, mm-hmm. That's intimidating. Even though those people are some of the nicest people in the game, it's you know, a person with a 0-0 person who comes in with 0 spy wins and 0 sniper wins and sees, you know, here's Drawn Onward with 1,185 spy wins. He's got an even number of spy and sniper wins. That's bizarre.
Yeah. Sorry to interrupt real quick, but a couple people are having problems. Not enough to restart, but I wanted to say that if you're having problems with my stream, you can go to twitch.tv/spyparty, and Chris is streaming on his end as well, so you can give that a shot. Right. Go on.
So it's just intimidating to see that number. And so people have suggested, oh, maybe there should just be like a, you know, a 5-star kind of thing. I mean, maybe keeping away from stars because that seems to have a value associated with it. Just, you know, like dots or something like that. It just shows experience level, like how long you've been in the game and things like that. I mean, it's just basically, I think that the key thing is it's a delicate and complicated system. And so not what I'm doing, but I mean like the way your brain reacts to ranking and stuff like that. And so I don't know, I want to tread carefully basically. I have a really cool skill-based ranking algorithm I want to implement that's like, you know, that was recommended to me by the TrueSkill people, which is like TrueSkill is really cool. It's what Xbox Live uses, but it's patented out the wazoo. And so this is a kind of a more modern version of it that's not patented. And so, I mean, there's some really awesome work in skill-based ranking, but man, you just want to be careful about showing somebody like an ELO score or, you know any kind of skill-based score that can go up and down based on like if you take a week off and your score goes down and you're like, oh man.
Yeah. All right, so why don't we get some rounds done? Let's play, and then I think in the middle we can. I mean, how do you want to do the surprise?
You tell me, man.
I was thinking we'll play a current with what we have, and then we'll discuss a little bit more. Then for the next set of rounds, we'll try and see how it goes.
Yeah, so the idea is we have a surprise, but it's going to require a build update, and God knows what I broke.
Yeah, so, I mean, so let's get some rounds done now.
Yeah, we're going to live update, and worst case scenario, I guess we roll back somehow, but oh man.
Yep.
Hopefully it'll work.
All right, so I've cleared my away message, so you can invite me.
Ah, okay.
Oh, let me change my Skype mic, too, so you can't hear my clicks and stuff, because the mouse clicks make a huge difference, as we discovered.
Nope. Now I can't hear you at all.
How about now?
Yeah.
Better? It should be not as high quality for you, but the stream can hear the normal mic. So.
Yep.
So the stream has the nicer mic. So so I guess I'll play Spy first, because I think Spy's, I guess from a newbie's perspective, is more fun to immediately follow. But
well, it's not quite as overwhelming as a newbie, for sure.
Let's see.
You want to show off? So you want to do some basic games first? You want to show off the new mission?
Oh yeah, there's a new mission. I forgot. Yeah, let me just go into preview spy mission. So the other day, Chris added a new mission called Purloin Guest List. So the spy needs to take the guest list from Toby's tray. Toby actually has mission significance now.
This is the first of Toby's mission significance, because he's eventually going to be part of Poison Drink too when that goes in.
Yep. So that's the red test. The green test makes it so that the next player swaps it, kind of like the green swap on a statue, but it's different, bit different, because it moves around. So, all right. So I'm gonna play spy on ballroom. Oh, wait. I'm in practice still. There, spy. What kind of loadout do you want? Something vanilla?
I don't know. I mean, are we handicapping the game for you or in my skill over? Or are you walking through it?
How about any 4 of 6? How's that?
And we'll play for real then.
Yeah. So make only 6 of 7. Tell you what, I'll make this extra easier.
Why don't we do any 4 of 7, just because that'll include everything.
Okay, that's fine.
Then you can kind of opportunistically talk to your... Are you going to talk to your stream or keep us on the... Are you going to mute me? Or how's this going to work?
Do you want to trash talk? but no, I can mute the mic so that I can give commentary on what I'm doing, because I'm sure there are still some new players.
Yeah, if you want to do that, that's probably the best for your stream, and then I'll just, should I?
I mute
Skype.
Right, correct. Yeah. So you, or mute the, there's a little microphone, mute your microphone icon, you just use that.
Right. Oh yeah, there's a little, that little thing does it too. Cool.
So, if anyone, I forgot to ask, do you have the Vine Sauce chat up, or are you just winging it?
I do not. I can't read. I can't even read my own chat with 45 people in there, let alone. I mean, how many people are in Vinechal's chat right now?
There are a lot. There's about 450, and probably maybe more.
So is the special person in chat? Can you check?
Well, I'll put it this way. It's going pretty slow right now. Like, I'm actually very impressed and proud of you guys. I'm sure saying that is going to cause a huge flood. But it's up to you.
I love
if you
going to Vine Sauce and checking it out, but it's more of as a tourist than I just cannot. I can't watch it and stream at the same time. It just overwhelms me completely.
But I was just curious if you were. But we do have KCM in chat and Drawn Onward. Those guys both have over 1,500, 2,000, 3,000, whatever games. So if anyone has any questions and we're in the middle of a match, then you can... ask them, and I'm sure they can answer. All right.
Well, so do you know for the surprise later? Do you know if the person in question is in the chat?
The per oh, he said he will be watching.
Okay.
He said he will be watching. I don't know for sure if he is watching, but I told him specifically that he should be watch this stream tonight.
So. I'm glad you remember who he is. That's good. All right. But, I'm going to blow my nose first. Here, hold on a second.
Okay. And then he was gone for 20 minutes. I'm just kidding.
That's about how it goes with me. oh, my God. Should I apologize again for 2 hours late?
Oh, it's fine, dude. Don't worry about it.
I mean, hopefully, everything will be forgiven if it goes off without a hitch. I tested it like okay, well, like it's going to be pretty funny and cool. There's a couple like laugh out loud moments, hopefully, but I mean, it could just all burn down in like, yeah, just complete disaster too. So we'll find out.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm going to mute so we can play.
Yes. So my stream, I'm going to mute Skype for now.
There you go. Okay, so my microphone is muted, and we're going to play. So I only need to complete 4 out of the 7 missions, so it's actually kind of more handicapped in my favor. So even though I have, if you look at our win ratios, I have about 4 times as many wins as he does. So, but he's the fucking developer, so we'll see how it goes when we start. So, like I said, this is the first map. You have some statues in the middle, some statues inside, 2 bookshelves, which have to do with microfilm. All right, here we are. So, these are the placeholder graphics while the game gets tuned, while the gameplay gets tuned. These are going to get replaced very soon. Ooh, I wonder if I can get a bug from this, from where I am. A little bit too far away. I thought I would try it. And no one's in conversation, so I could contact the double agent now, but it wouldn't be very wise. Oh, geez, she really wanted to shove me over. Will I win against the developer himself? I don't know. Maybe. Okay, now. I'm not sure what happened, but... So I'm going to take my time a little bit. See, I'm just gonna read my book here. Green. So that little Gears of War style test determines how well I complete my mission when I do a spy action. And I'm not gonna book because that would be too obvious, and the fact that I got close to the ambassador might make him think I'm less suspicious. Because when one of the missions is bugging the ambassador, and you have to get really close to do that. I might also be overthinking it, because I know... Let's see, this is pretty busy conversation. Well, no, that's not true. There's still a lot of people out. Let's wait for a couple of these folks to enter conversation, and then I'm going to do a banana bread. So Red Dress is heading over. That's fine.
Banana bread.
And I'm going to... he probably saw that I left pretty quick there. Let's just do inspect. I thought about swapping, decided not to, because swapping would probably be obvious, especially since this statue is very visible. And I really gotta start to speed up. I know he's also watching Toby pretty intensely because of the new mission. Where's his laser? It's on the other side. Okay, got a nice bug there. I think that if I was playing KC, he would have caught that, but I guess I got away with it with Checker. So now, let's go over this conversation with Toby so we can hopefully avoid any suspicious calling. You can actually request a drink from Toby like this and purloin the guest list. I got a green, so it won't even swap until the next person picks up. I'm actually going to gulp and make it seem like I didn't have a drink at all if I'm lucky. If he does notice that, then I'm going to get caught. But so now Purloin is waiting to be swapped. The next person to pick up a drink from Toby. Oh, shit. Oh, I didn't mean to do that. Extra missions, whatever. I'm just going to stay here because I don't want someone to swap this and mess me up. I meant to inspect, and I ended up swapping. Ugh. There we go.
Nicely done.
Thank you. Yeah, it was funny. Because at the very end, I went to get my last inspected, and I accidentally swapped.
Oh, did you?
Yeah. Well, it was a pending swap. That's the beautiful part. If I didn't get a green, it would have been right away, and you probably would have caught me. But I got a green. So
I was looking back there, because I was looking back there when you picked it up, because I had you highlight. I don't. When did I highlight you? I highlight you.
Let's say inspect. Because what happened was I did a double agent, and then I immediately went to the statues, and it was not...
That you were the banana split guy.
Yep. Exactly. And because it was a very late split. Like, if you're going to banana split, I should have either just done it all the way or just stayed in there, but...
Right. I was talking about banana splits on my stream, because I don't know how many of your guys are on my stream versus the usual suspects, so I was kind of trying to be a little bit more, but I'm terrible at talking. I actually was talking about how bad I am at reacting to banana breads in terms of highlights and lowlights. I mean, so there's the, like, you know, there's the base level strategy of, like, which I'm still trying to practice at, which is, like, highlight or lowlight people after the banana bread and get the party done, you know, sort the party that way.
Right, just start to just basically process the information.
Yeah, exactly, and react to it fast enough. And then there's a strategy beyond that, which I'm not even close to, which is, like, be watching for other stuff while that's happening. That's what, I mean, the elite players, of which I am definitely not anymore, but I hope to become again, which is actually something we could talk about, actually. There's not a lot of panic at the banana bread when, you know, whereas I'm like, oh, I got to go lowlight everybody. Oh, did I miss somebody? Oh, what's that going to
be? Right,
you know?
Totally.
Which you can take advantage of as a good spy, right? Because you know the person's panicking.
Yeah, I mean, that's been a pretty, I guess, common strategy. I mean, even, like, even viewers who don't play Spy Party have suggested, oh, why don't you banana bread when the statue's about to be swapped, so to distract him away from that swap when it happens.
Right, and I think that's where the purloined guest list thing is going to really come in handy a lot. It's like, you know, as Toby serves a drink, you know, if purloined is active, like, people are going to be watching, you know, snipers are going to be watching Toby, and that provides some extra cover for some of the hardtail missions. Are you want to do the same mode again, or do you want to,
Let's do the same loadout. I think that was a good loadout. I was saying earlier that I think it was actually more handicapped, in my favor, that one.
Yes.
Definitely.
Yes, it
so
was.
why don't we stick with the same one, and this time it'll be a bit more proper.
All right. But the idea of handicapping in your favor was because I wasn't sure how much tutorializing you were going to do on your stream.
Yeah, exactly. And I was going to say to the chat, I mean, I'll answer questions about the basics and stuff, but I don't want to spend too much time explaining the very basics because I want to spend most of our time, you know, discussing the game and interviewing and all that fun stuff. But I'll try to. Basically, banana bread is the code word used to contact the double agent. If the double agent's in conversation, you say banana bread, and that mission is considered complete. Anyone not in conversation, it cannot be a spy. But you can bail and make it appear like
you
you're
can
out
do
of conversation.
It. And there's different actually, you know, different qualities of contacting the double agent, including one that coughs if you fail it. So.
yeah, the little Gears of War test. If I fail that test, which is unlikely, but it does happen. If you fail that test, there's actually coughing, which
Well, the obviously... funny thing is it's unlikely. It's an opt-in risk. Right? I mean, the whole design behind the action test was that, you know, if you don't opt in, it's you're guaranteed a white test every time.
Right.
But if you opt in and go for the green, you might hit red.
Yeah, especially because I always get green right on the edge, right at the edge of the safe zone, and that's where probably 95% of my reds go. Like, I think I got to get used to just, you know, it's biting the bullet and taking just opting out or taking a white on purpose.
Yeah, or just always round towards the middle. You know, always biased towards the middle of the white. It's just really those are really hard things for your brain to get wrapped around.
Yeah, it's funny because they're. I can't remember the exact scenario, but I actually wanted a white, and I got a green by accident when I was playing someone. Because there are some more advanced strategies that involve deliberately getting white due to the nature of various missions.
Yeah, because we will, and the differential there is white talks first and green doesn't.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Let's play.
Okay.
Orange dress, right?
Yes. Orange dress is fetishized by some people on the forums. It used to be the plaid guy, but now orange dress.
Oh, I don't remember. I don't know if I was around.
Very
for that
early
one.
In the beta, the plaid guy just got shot all the time.
Yeah, I think I remember you posting some metrics on that, he got shot more often than anyone else.
The James Bond-looking guy never got shot, so it was better to pick him. But I haven't run those metrics in a long time, so I don't know what the truth is now.
Mm-hmm. All right, I'm going to mute.
Okay, me too.
Alrighty, so now I am sniping. The sniper has some tools at his or her disposal in order to catch the spy, such as highlighting people who he wants to track and low-lighting people who he is pretty confident is not a spy in order to kind of weed out the noise of the party. Make sure he's ready. So I gotta watch for all 7 of these missions, and he can complete any 4 of them in order to win. So 111 in the back, and 131 on the left. So there's only one unique statue. I use numbers to memorize the statue shapes. That way I can very easily tell if someone is inspecting. Let's see, so Danger is taking a drink. These guys are suspicious just because they went to middle statue. Guest list is still there. He's been there for quite a while, that guy in the back, I think. I could be wrong. So I can't even see if the list is still there. I'm pretty sure it still is. But this guy was there for a very long time. If he took too long on his inspects, that would explain that. Guest list is still there. And now he's also hitting up the bookshelf. Let's see, these two have not been doing much at all, which is definitely risky for me to low light them flat out, but I feel pretty confident with that. Well, no, Danger actually went to the shelf, so I'm gonna keep him up. Now he's doing the statue. That's 3 mission targets in a row. She's back actually at the same statue, which I don't think Checker would do, although a better spy might do on purpose in order to seem less suspicious. Let's see, the guest list is still there. Oh man, so many. I'm pretty confident in him just from, because what are the odds that he would visit 3 targets in a row, but you still never know. And I also think is it gone? I think the list is gone now. Let's see, who doesn't have a drink? Let's assume that he took a drink at some point recently. That would mean him. He does not have a drink. He does have a drink. She has a drink. That would make it him, if it's anyone. He also has a drink, but he hasn't left anywhere. He just finished his drink. Yeah, I'm looking at who has and has not. Then he went to the statue immediately to the side. I don't think that's something Checker would do, but you never know. I'm going to start neutral lighting too, just in case one of my deductions was wrong. He went into conversation, talked immediately. The other guys have been pretty inactive. He could be getting his seduce done. She's leaving. Can't even see the statue anymore.
Banana bread.
Banana split, there was. You see that banana split? Pretty sure. Oh no! I overestimated you. I thought you banana split.
No, I totally I let the time get out from under me. I didn't play totally poorly, I don't think, but I totally let the time get away from me.
Oh, man. See, and I should have trusted my instinct there, because I had a feeling that you weren't done, but I didn't. After that banana bread, I didn't want to risk it.
Yeah.
Well, then again, wait, hang on. You contacted, that was with less than 10 seconds, so I should have at least waited.
Yeah, you shouldn't have shot.
In that sense, it was dumb.
Yeah. I hung out too long. I just was not doing good time management there.
Yeah.
So I'm glad you did.
There you go. So my trigger finger earned me the loss there.
Exactly. That only usually happens once a game, though, or once a match. So what did you notice the guest list was gone?
Yes, I did. And I low-lit everyone who did not have a drink at that time.
Ah, okay. So maybe if I had... How long did you... Is that what the... That was,
well, let's
oh,
see.
Okay, I see.
146. Yeah, it was about 30 after. Seconds later, yeah.
So if I had gulped, I wonder if you would have low-lit
yeah,
me.
And I've been doing that a lot in my matches. Like, I did that against you last match, actually. Okay. I tried to gulp, but I got to watch that a bit closer. All right, let's do two on balcony.
Okay. So I fixed balcony in the new build, so any two of three will be back, but for now, any two of four is our only option, I think.
Okay. Yeah, so I was balcony, playing any three of four earlier, and it's nearly impossible.
Yeah, but. Yeah. Well, so do you want to talk about balcony as the, like, kind of originally thought to be just the kind of, like, lighthearted arcade mode, but then it turned out to be the most behavioral of all the maps?
Yeah, I mean, I guess we kind of just did.
Okay.
But yeah, this map is very small, only seven people. It's kind of just like the lightning round style. Like, you really, the matches are over like that, and it's fun. It's very addictive, I would say. I think balcony is the most addictive map of the bunch.
Casey, I'm saying you can do the honor system. If you want to do A2 of 3, select A2 of 4, and then just announce which one you're not going to do.
What do you want to do?
I think we'll just do A2 of 4, and then we'll
just
play the A2 of 3. Yeah, yeah. All right, muting.
Okay.
You ready?
Yep.
Okay.
All right, so I'm the spy on this tiny, tiny map. I need to complete two missions. And I'm first going to flirt because I happen to land right next to my seduction target. So, got a white, so it's 34%. The better my action test on seduce, the more percentage my seduce target meter goes up by. Let's go over here. Not too close. If I get too close to her, it'll look like I'm trying to seduce her, which I definitely don't want. Did he see it? Oh, I was hoping for green. Luckily, there's like three people talking. Three. There we go. Ooh, had to play a little bit aggressive there.
I was like, he could be done. Oh, yeah, he's done.
Yeah, I thought that
you got a bug in. Good.
Yeah, I thought you highlight me on that bug. I wasn't totally sure.
I did not highlight you on the bug. I highlight you...
The double agent. And that was really lucky on my end because there were like three people talking at the same time. It was really bizarre.
Yeah, well, actually, I highlight you then, but it was also because you left this conversation and came back in.
Oh, gotcha.
And so I was like, that wasn't worth the highlight by itself. Although maybe
that's the anti-KC strategy, meaning it's the opposite of what KC was doing for a while. Because I remember during the memorial, or what was it, the tournament, the recent tournament, the metagame on balcony, it was so strongly that spies never left conversation.
Right.
That KC would actually lowlight every person who even left conversation, which is like the biggest gamble in the world.
Wow, that's such a huge gamble. Although a lot of people are pretty fluid with their lowlights and be like, I watch Viri games, Virifo, and like, man, he brings people back from lowlights all the time. Where I
yeah,
can't,
and
like,
I'm trying to do that more too. Well, I mean, the thing is, I don't lowlight enough to have that be as useful. Like, I think I got to get more lowlights and lowlight more confidently before I focus on that more. But
yeah, I think a lot of the elite players have a lot more fluid style with the low lights and highlights than I do. All right, with balcony A2.
Yeah, I was exaggerating. I mean, I think KC would only he wouldn't take such a strong gamble, but that was a big part of it because spies were so unlikely to leave conversation with the current metagame.
Indeed. All right.
Right.
Muting and ready.
Yep. Okay. So let's take a look. Danger. That was a nice switch. I'm actually going to low light for that because it looked like his destination got
banana bread
taken. He was talking during that banana bread. He actually just finished, though, which makes me think it might have been a green because, well, I don't know. Sometimes the banana bread is really late in the talking animation. That is a low light and a half for both of those guys. Because that is something that a human has a lot of difficulty pulling off, that autocorrect going on. You'll notice that a lot of my deductions are just based on... Oh, shit. Holy shit, dude. Nice job.
Thanks. I figured the best strategy. I really pushed the talk key instead of unmuting.
And you got away with purloin, which is the first time I've seen on balcony.
Well,
but
I totally lucked out. I thought I was going to go. Actually, I had a plan that totally didn't work out, which was that I was going to try and white test it and make it look like a green test. But nobody took a drink before, or at least it was a couple very early. But then I just decided to go for it because I just cannot resist the purloin right now because it's so new and fresh.
Right. And it's funny. I was saying that earlier. I was like, Checker's going to do a purloin at some point.
No, I mean, it's like, it's totally, I mean, in the stream last night when I was releasing it, Casey was like, the analogy he made is like, oh, someone brought me a statue. Would you like to swap it? Like, totally.
Yeah, but then, absolutely.
But then you swung around right as I did it, and then you were blocked by Plaid for the whole countdown. So I was like, oh, I'm going to make it. And then I ran for it at the very end, just in case.
Yeah, totally. Well, still very nicely done. It was funny. I just didn't even think of purloin. Like, I guess I was explaining about how I was low lighting for pathing and other complex things.
Right.
And then you got away with a very obvious mission. So it's kind of funny how advanced players will get caught up in some of the, I guess, their advantages, meaning like an experienced player's advantages of being able to recognize things like that and just totally every once in a while brain fart on something really basic.
Yeah. I mean, I love the fact that you have to change your playstyle based on the skill level of the player playing. Like, you can't just take elite playstyles against a mid-range player because you lose a lot.
Right, and I think that's very unique to Spy Party. Like, that doesn't work. I mean, occasionally, I guess, in fighting games, because you'll like, a newbie will throw you off and with something totally inane. But I think that's unique to Spy Party in the sense that you have to do that. Like, it's a requirement to win against all levels.
Right, I guess that's true. I'm trying to think of other games where that's true, because a lot of the other games where this, like, you know, if you think about RTSs or FPSs, the superior skill is just completely dominant in all situations.
Pretty much.
Yeah, but this is because there's just a one bit of information. Like, you know, a newbie sniper still has a bullet, right? Mm-hmm. Like, someone's going to go down. And so, yeah, it just makes this choice. Like, there's that great thread in the forums where people are talking about why not to use the random number generator. Like, in other words, you can leave the AI in control for a long time, but the AI will sometimes put you in incriminating situations.
Right. If you get really good at mimicking AI, it's better to take control and not be an AI so that you can make sure that you don't do anything suspicious.
Yeah, do you remember the last game we played on balcony? I mean, on ballroom, at the very beginning when I was at the bookshelf, there was a conversation and you could at least see that it had the ambassador and a suspected double agent.
Mm-hmm.
It actually had the real double agent and the seduction target in it, and I was like, I'm not going anywhere near that conversation.
Yeah,
for that exact reason. Like, there's no way I'm going to incriminate myself by going over there.
Exactly. Yeah.
Should we update the build?
Do you want to do that
right now? What do you want to do?
Can you talk while you update? I know that it's taxing.
Let's talk, then update.
Okay. So, I mean, I love Purloin, by the way. That's a great... a lot of people are commenting on just how well-balanced it is and well-refined it is for
being
a new mission.
I was going to reply. I meant to... the reason I didn't earlier... There's a thread where we're discussing, you know, sort of some backstory for the stream. There's some thread where we're discussing the mission. Like, you know, it just went in last night. Like. Mm-hmm. And unlike the changes I'm about to put in, like, it got a little more testing by me locally, but it still was pretty raw. But and people are like, man, it just feels so, like, tight already. And I mean, some of that's due to my obviously immense programming skill, but some of that is just like, man, this game design is just a sponge for interesting ideas. Like, you can just throw almost anything at it and it just goes in so clean. It's really, I mean, knock on wood, but like, everything I've put in, like, there's just been very few cases where something like just totally didn't work, or like, you know, kind of felt totally broken or whatever.
Part of it's the design, and part of it's also just flat player creativity.
Yeah, well, because it gives such a great stage for that kind of thing, and because it's so psychological, like, even little things that in a more micro-oriented game that might be weird about something, like, can be worked around, you know, and even turned into an advantage here. And so I would love to take credit for how, you know, polished Purloin is right now, but just some of that is just like, I just lucked into this just really awesome game design sponge of an idea here.
Yeah, totally. So what was I going to say? I wanted to get back to communities, but I mean, we did discuss that a lot.
One thing I realized, this happened last time too, which is like, we start on a thing and then the stream reminds us, like, you know, 10 minutes later, it's like, oh, you forgot to finish that list. So I realized I didn't finish my five kinds of diversity. Should I go through those?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, Okay, so there's like in-game diversity of like the characters, and that's the one we talked about already. And then there's the community diversity, you know, like are trans people or, you know, gay people or women feel welcome in the community. So that's community diversity. And we can talk about any of these more. I'm just listing them. So mm-hmm. there's
so
in-game
one.
Kind of fictional diversity. There's and like the only kind of diversity I think that or the main kind of diversity I think that SpyParty is going to be missing from an in-game fiction standpoint, because the goal I want to make it as diverse as I can, but not like, but I want it to be fictionally like relevant, is there's class diversity is not going to happen. I mean, it's a fancy cocktail party, right? Like there's not going to be, which is an important kind of diversity, right? Like but there are other games that are going to need to tackle that one. So I'm going to tackle as many kinds of diversity as I can, but I don't think class diversity is going to make the cut. Mm-hmm. But, so we got in-game fictional diversity. We got community diversity, skill diversity, which is something we kind of talked about with like level of handy. I want to be able to like, I don't know if you've ever played Go, but Go's like my favorite game.
I've tried. Well, I mean, yeah. Like I get the basic concept, but there's just,
right.
It seems it's
a very,
like
very
insurmountable.
Simple game. Yeah, it's a very simple game with just an infinite amount of skill, but it's got this really amazing handicapping system, and you can handicap incredibly wide skill gaps. It's the most handicappable game I've ever seen. And so, I want skill diversity as well. I want a newbie to be able to play an elite player, and them to have both of them have an interesting time. And so there's the mentoring aspect of that, which is one thing. But I also want to I want it to be able to be an actual game, an actual play. Challenging for both players. Mm-hmm. So, you know, by setting the number of missions, like we did any 4 of 7, you can do known 7 when you're playing a newbie. You know, once you've trained, once you've mentored them up a little bit and they know what to look for, you can do known 7, and it's kind of a death trap for the spy, but if you're really good, they can still not notice things. So I don't think it's as good as Go and from a handicap ability standpoint, but that's a huge thing. What else is there? And then the fourth one, I thought maybe there were four. I can't remember if there were four or five. But then the fourth one is developer diversity, which is like I'm a white guy, like middle-aged white guy. So like I'm not going to be there. There's a lot of emphasis on developer diversity in the industry nowadays. You know, more black game developers, more women. Mm-hmm. There's a whole community of like art game developers that have a way higher diversity than the industry at large, and so that's totally great. And like. That was one of the things I was talking to. I don't know if you know who Anna Anthropy is. Are you familiar with Anna?
I am not.
So she's one of the more famous like art game developers from the standpoint. She wrote a book called Rise of the Zinester, Video Game Zinesters, basically about diversity of developers, like you know, making it so that it's not just you know programmers who are making video games, you know, white middle class programmers. It's like you know, you want everybody to be able to make games. I went to lunch with her actually the day the Kotaku interview hit, and we were talking about that a little bit because developer diversity doesn't get a lot of play,
right?
So that's it's another really cool kind of diversity that. That I think is hopefully changing. You know, actually, since Evo's coming up next week, I wanted to mention, like, the fighting game community is incredibly diverse.
Definitely.
You know, they've got a bad name from a misogyny standpoint about, like, gender diversity, but man, from a racial diversity standpoint, I had never seen anything like that in a tech, you go to PAX and it's a bunch of white dudes, like, almost every other conference like that, and, like, there are so many, I mean, there's Asian, obviously, but there's so many...
What does that mean, huh? Asian, yeah. Obviously. No, I'm just kidding.
I mean, there's like a lot of Asian fighting games. I mean,
yeah.
At Evo, but like, there's also just a huge number of African Americans there. I mean, it was just incredibly diverse. I couldn't believe it. There was like, you know, a ton of Latinos, and I mean, it's almost all guys, like most video game conferences. Sadly, I mean, there were women there, but in the same way that there are women at PAX, you know, it's like dwarfed by the number of dudes. But man, I was really impressed with the racial diversity there. It was pretty amazing.
For those that don't know, Spy Party will be at Evo again next week, actually.
Yeah.
Or was it this weekend? Or next
it's,
weekend?
It's Friday, Saturday, Sunday coming up.
Okay, so this upcoming weekend, if you live or can get to Las Vegas.
Yes, and in fact, the top of the leaderboard in Spy Party right now, KCMMMM, is going to work. He lives in Vegas, and he's got a camping trip Saturday and Sunday, but he's going to work the booth on Friday. So if you'd like to get your ass handed to you by the top of the Spy Party leaderboard, come by on Friday. And the funny thing about that is, I don't know, you know who Seth Killian is? He's kind of like a Yoda of the fighting game community. He invited me... He invited me last year, and that's when they put together this indie showcase thing that they were doing again this year.
Right.
Wodar saying on that one of the people in chat is saying that KCMMMMM is not the top, and that's just because there's one person who has two alts, neither of whom individually are at the top, but if you add them together, they're way beyond everyone else.
They're a landslide. It's crazy.
Yeah, Bureau. But at the rate he's playing, he's quick approaching from the bottom as well on the with any individual, so he's going to be untouchable soon. But where was I? Seth invited me and wanted to know if I was interested in showing Spy Party last year before the indie showcase thing was a thing. And I was like, yeah, totally. But, you know, tell me a little bit about the community. And he's like, well, they're awesome. They're really into competition, competitive gaming. And these sort of, they warned me not to use the word esports around the FGC. But he said, and it was kind of a one-off, like just like on a lark, he's like, I bet if you come, your best player will be from the fighting game community. And I was like, yeah, right. I mean, who knows? Like, you can't tell that. But then I realized when Casey took the top of the leaderboard last month, I was mentioning this because I'm going to do an interview with Casey tomorrow and post it on the blog, and it's going to go on Shuriken and Joystick, actually.
Oh, wow, awesome.
So, about his roots in the fighting game community and what games he likes and just Spy Party and stuff like that. So, but anyway, Seth was like, wait a second, I bet you a beer that the top player would be from the fighting game community. I was like, oh my god, you totally did.
A year or so later, you're gonna give him that beer.
Exactly, and he can gloat. I'll mention it prominently in my article.
Get him something nice, like a really really fine beer.
Like a banana bread beer.
About the banana bread. Of course. All right. So do you want to get on to the so much talked about surprise?
You want to do this? Okay. All right. How should we do this? Should we just update the build and happens?
Sure. You can talk about... I know you had a video first. Did you want to preface that first? Or preface with that video?
Yeah. Let's do that in case the build doesn't work at all. So, okay. All right. So, so what's the guy's name? Do you remember?
In chat, he used to go by Lone Gentleman. Now it's actually Misanthropy. Or Misanthropy.
Okay. So, in the very first VineSauce chat that, you were just playing, I think I wasn't in there, but I was just, it was not during our interview because I wasn't watching chat. It was just I stopped by one time after you started playing in the beta. And, people were brainstorming randomness as usual, and the chat was going by a million miles a minute. And I caught somebody was talking about levels, and someone said, "Oh, what about a panopticon?"
Yep. And you said, "What's a panopticon?"
I was like, "Wait, yeah. I've had name before." Yeah. Of course, Wikipedia, and I was like, "Oh, right. Oh, that is a great idea for a." Party level, it's totally worth trying. And so that was in the back of my mind, always going to be the next the next Spy Party level that I did. And so my net is dropping.
It's okay. For those that don't know what a panopticon is, it's basically a design for a prison. It's kind of a circular design with a tower in the center that is designed to make the inmates, every single inmate in the prison, feel watched but not knowing whether or not they're being watched, I guess. It's like they have a guard tower in the center, and it's facing outward in all these cells in a big circle around the guard tower so that they can see everyone from that center tower. That's what a panopticon is.
Yes. My internet is trying to die really quick here. Wait, is it coming back?
And so you're slowly getting higher quality, at least on my end. Maybe?
Yeah.
Okay.
Wait. The one thing I don't want to do is update the build and then have my internet die, and then the build breaks everything, and then I can't fix it, and then we're all screwed.
It could just be because we're both streaming and both connected on Skype.
No, I think this is my net. I'm just trying to wait until it kind of settles down here a little bit. Grim. Okay, so I'm just gonna sit here and talk for a while. Hopefully it'll work itself out here. Comcast, come on, Comcast. Everyone think good Comcast karma.
There you go.
Okay.
As difficult as that is to do sometimes. But yeah.
Yes. Okay. So I started trying. So I'm way behind. I was going to do a new map and a new mission. And originally I was going to do the new map first. But then when you talked about doing the second, you know, we'd been putting off the second half of this interview until after the beta was open, and you know, due to timing and stuff, it turned out that I needed to do the mission first because you were gone for a little while and I was gone, so I was like, okay, I did the mission, and that was supposed to be done a week and a half ago and got done last night at like I don't even know what time I updated the build. Okay, so that got, and since I'd already pushed the interview with you back multiple times, that actually meant that I had to do the map today in one day with no testing.
Oh,
oy vey. So the very first thing I did was implement an actual panopticon, and it totally did not work for reasons that are totally obvious from this video. So here, I'll send out the chat video. I'll send out the video to chat.
I'd say I have it on hand if you just want me to show on stream.
Yeah, you showed on your stream, and I'll give it to the chat here.
Should I just play it?
So people can watch it. Yeah, go for it. It's just, I mean, everyone who's motion sensitive, be careful because it's total vomit cam. basically, it took like 4 seconds to rotate all the way around. Here, I'm going to play it muted so I can see what people are seeing. It took like almost 4 seconds to get around, even at vomit-inducing speeds. And so there was just no way. It was just way too big. It was huge. It was like 5 times bigger than Veranda or something, like in terms of like the number of if you're looping the video right now, that's 20 people, and you see how sparse it is.
Yeah, that's like the whole party, isn't it?
Yeah, no, 20 is higher than Veranda. So jeez. It was just, there was so much space. And like, the funny thing about this video is like, because there were no, you know, there's no bookshelves or anything in there yet. So they have nothing to do. There's no places to window. So they're just standing still, except for Toby's going around serving them drinks. So they're just standing
and
in one place
just standing
getting
there.
Sloshed. Yeah. Take a drink when Toby comes up. And it's just like, yeah. So, as Zero says in chat, like just watching it is making you dizzy. Like people, you know, there's a game mode that people have been playing around with, like on Courtyard, which is the first map you could actually do a loop around. That is just basically you have to like hold down left or right and just keep going.
Uh-huh.
And it's just total vomit camp as well. Whereas this was like, because it's on the inside, it's even worse. And
right.
I couldn't figure out how to get it to work on the controller right, because controllers, you know, obviously one of the reasons controllers are not as good for shooters is because the rotation speed's not as high. And so, but rotation speed would be everything on that map, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, okay, this is never going to be playable on a controller versus a, you know, I'm trying to keep the game. The nice thing about Spy Party relative to most player skill games is there's no advantage really from the controller to the mouse and keyboard. There's a very tiny like sniper advantage, but most of the maps are not based on, you know, aim speed,
right,
basically. And so that means that what I'm going to do when I finally release the game on consoles is allow console and PC play on the same leaderboards, basically, because
oh,
there's
boy.
No advantage. It's all it's swarmed
right,
by skill.
Right, right. It's
whereas,
the only real Twitch
that,
still
right?
is the AT or the ATs for spies, and still that's
yeah,
still
yeah, yeah.
randomized. So
yeah, I mean there is some skill. Oh, my net's still dying. Come on.
There's a little bit, but mostly it's just like attention resource management.
Right. Exactly. And so like you know there have been shooters that there have been shooters that have tried to do combined play, like Shadowrun, I believe did, but they apparently had to nerf the mouse keyboard
right.
into nothingness to
yeah.
make it competitive. So, but I realized this would be the first game that you could really get and have it actually just all be shared on the same leaderboard. So I didn't like this. That map wasn't going to work from that standpoint either. Like it just was not. I got in there and I was like already feeling ooky.
Wait, so was that preview video? Was that just from? Did you say that was just from earlier today?
Oh yeah.
That oh
was
wow.
Like 3 hours ago.
So yeah, this was like totally from scratch today.
Coming in hot does not begin to describe what's happening. What's about to happen here? Okay, so what I did was instead of the vomit cam, I cut off the map to only to like 120 degrees, to the point where I don't know if you scroll in the video, you can see the sniper's view. This is basically, at when you're zoomed out, in the FOV, is basically one set of windows, right? So there's three sets of windows now.
Right. Okay.
I cut it off and I put little, like, you know, museum like barriers there, so, you know, like a little velvet rope, so you can't go past there.
Gotcha.
And it's still giant. It's basically three ballrooms.
Wow.
In terms of size, it's a little bit thinner, but so it's a little bit thinner but wider, and it's I mean, who even knows, right? We're about to find out.
Yeah.
all right, I'm gonna do this.
All right, so we are actually updating the build live. You're getting
yes. Do you have your splash ready? Because you don't want to update the build on once.
Yeah. One sec. Yeah, one time he updated the build live on one of his streams for release notes, and there's like an epileptic flash.
Yeah, it flashed.
It was really weird. I guess XSplit was. Oh wait, no. Do you use XSplit or do you use FFSplit?
I use OBS.
Oh, OBS. Or yeah. Sorry, OBS. So I don't know if that's OBS or an XSplit
thing.
But
as soon as you when you're in the main menu, just right before you hit the update button on the main menu, you can download it and everything. It's fine. Assuming my net stays up long enough. What's going to be awesome here is the build's going to go out, the net will go down, and then we'll call each other on the cell phone. You'll have to tell me how the game worked out.
There you go. All right. So
should be hitting the server here pretty soon.
Just waiting for it.
It's still uploading S3 right now. I use Amazon Cloud stuff for the actual build distribution and whatnot.
Mm-hmm. I was going to say that I know I Lone said he was going to be watching, but that was also a lot earlier. I haven't seen him in chat, but if he is watching, then this is all.
Well, this stream is dedicated to him.
Right. Because this map we're about to put in was actually a Vine Saucer's idea. It's funny.
Yeah, if this all goes pear-shaped, it's his fault, is basically what we're trying to say.
Yeah, right, exactly. This is us.
It's up on S3, which means the lobby server will discover it within a minute. So we're about to get a incoming build.
Mm-hmm. Oh boy!
I'm gonna chat. I'm gonna set my good example. Hi, all new people I haven't said hi to.
There you go. Yeah, this is exciting. Update available. Let's do it. Downloading.
Okay.
Now I update Spy Party. Yes. Are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Okay, good.
I'm downloading.
All right, and that should be good. Let me just get the screen selection up.
I'm a little behind you because of my...
It's okay.
Freaky.
There we go. Hands. There's a room. There's two rooms in the lobby right now. One is headquarters, and one is just hands.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, oops, I disconnected from the lobby. Oh, that was weird. Oh, it disconnected me automatically after a minute. All right, so I'm almost done here.
Oh, boy.
I'm going to put my splash screen up. You see it?
Yeah, I'm looking Panopticon Experimental 7 missions. Oh, a yellow bookshelf. Yellow.
Well, I figured the red and the green were having problems with the colorblind folks, so I figured this time we'll try it out with some
there
blue,
you go.
Yellow,
yeah.
And what did I do? Blue, yellow, and red?
Blue... Yeah, blue, yellow, red. Yeah, I can talk.
All right. And
I'm just going to walk around a little bit and get a feel for it. Man. I like the tree in the middle. So I'm just doing practice mode and just, you know.
Yeah,
wow,
yeah.
I'm wide.
I'm in the lobby net. It's huge.
I say it's kind of a combination. Like, I remember I suggested a level once that was just a huge straight line, and the sniper had to play with like peripheral vision pretty much to see everything correctly.
Right.
But it's kind
yeah,
of
I
want to
do a map. I actually took a note from that. I think that was you. I took a note. I want to do like an art gallery, you know, kind of like a Soho style art gallery where it's basically really, really deep but really narrow. And so basically the sniper can only see through the center, but there's a ton of occlusion. Oh, the practice mode laser is broken, so you don't get to see the sniper laser.
Oh, wow. This is still great, though.
What's that?
I said that this is great. The map is great. I really like that.
Chaos.
It's literally impossible to see. Because, like, with, I guess...
With Veranda, there's a couple places which are really sweet spots.
Now, I assume you should be able to see the leaves as the sniper.
So go into sniper mode. Go to practice sniper.
Yeah, I was going to say I can see the leaves. I just want to make sure that wasn't a bug, but that's awesome.
I decided to leave that in there. I just thought it was funny. I don't know if I'll take it out eventually, but...
no, I like it. It's really cool.
But the hilarious thing about the Panopticon is that, like, because you can see the middle, like, where's the sniper? He's got to be somewhere.
So he's in the tree. He's literally in the tree. That's really funny.
It's a bummer that the practice mode lasers broken just due to the way I had to hack in the ability to rotate without moving. But the laser comes out of the tree in spy network mode.
Oh, wow. All right, let's play.
You can shoot through columns. So even though you can, if you look, you can hide basically completely behind the two wide columns, but the laser goes right through it.
Right.
So you can highlight and shoot through it.
Will the columns stop the laser from the spy's perspective?
No, it goes right through them.
Okay, so there you cannot. The only way you can hide the laser is by pointing down, pretty much, or up.
Yeah.
Or no, just down, really.
It's so visible on this map. There's nothing. You can't hide the laser on this map. There's just no way. You can just not move. But because, I mean, the spy can always just look right into the center of the map. The laser's always coming straight out of the tree somewhere, and so there's nothing you can. Best bet is just not moving.
Oh, wow.
I like the little rope barriers, though.
Yeah. Yeah, it's cool.
All right. Try it out. First map, first game.
All right. I feel intimidated. Let's do it. Do you want to do sniper or spy first?
I mean, I've never played this map with any other humans.
Oh,
I have
God.
No idea.
I'll do sniper first.
Honestly, do you want to sit in a tree or do you want to sit?
Yeah, exactly.
All right, you're in the tree.
Oh, boy.
So what do we... I don't even know what the over-under on this map is. Like.
Yeah, I mean, we'll find out. There is no metagame for this map right now. It's one of those rare, very rare circumstances.
Any 5 of 7. How about that?
Okay, that sounds good because it's a big map.
It's giant.
I think from the looks of it, this map is going to be... the most sniper disadvantage map there is, like, more so than Veranda, I think.
Yeah, I mean, it's way obscure. Who knows? I mean, like, there's no way to tell.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, it's more occluded than Veranda because it's also, not only can you not see bigger chunks of the map, like, way bigger chunks, like, two-thirds of the map are always not visible to you. But it takes a long time if you're on one side to get to the other, relatively speaking.
Right. Absolutely.
It needs tuning on the controller, but not that many people play sniper controller right now. So.
Oh, no way. I for a little while, I was actually switching. I was doing a spy controller and then mouse and keyboard sniper just because I found myself hitting action test better on controller.
Yeah, yeah.
And eventually I just got lazy.
There are other players who do
this. Wow, 20 party goers. All right, you ready?
Yep.
We're gonna mute mics anyway.
Are we muting or are we just trash talking this very first game?
Oh, let's trash talk. I think that'd be better.
Yeah, let's trash talk the first game because if something goes wrong, we need to be able to talk to the other person.
Yeah, I'm gonna switch to my mic just for when I am a spy. You can still hear me?
Yep.
All right, good. All right, let's do it. You ready?
Do it. Yeah.
I immediately hit A on the keyboard like to zoom left. It was really strange. Oh, wow. Oh, boy.
The laser coming out of the tree is just absurd. Total absurdity.
Yeah, I was wondering if maybe you would put in, like, a silhouette or something.
No, I refuse to make an embodiment for the sniper. There's no way.
One thing that I've noticed is, and I'm afraid that saying this is going to change your strategy in mid-game, but I noticed that it's a lot easier to tell when someone's been inactive. Like, I guess the fact that you're categorizing the different zones more than on any other map as a sniper.
True. Yeah, that's an interesting point.
Like, I noticed, like, I was like, so-and-so has not moved from this conversation. Usually I don't make that observation so easily.
Yeah, because you're totally... keeping track of who's in which section. I had to make it an 8-sided thing because the pather is currently, the way the pathing system works is currently a cardinal axes, you know, north, northeast, you know, the eight cardinal axes. And so in order to avoid, you know how the pathing gets a little crazy on Courtyard, where there's mm-hmm. that curve, and only a few people like Drawn and people like that are really good at navigating it?
Yeah.
I needed to make it the eight cardinal directions so that you could walk straight on each segment, and mm-hmm. it wasn't like rah, 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 on the middle segment. So that I'm glad that worked out.
Oh man, this map.
Is it brutal?
I think so.
Need more missions.
I say it's kind of ironic considering the Panopticon concept because
yes,
it's the most
you're supposed
limited.
To have the advantage, right?
Right. Take it.
Nice work.
Oh yes, I was good. No, the funny part is the reason I shot him was because I don't remember seeing yellow on yellow.
Oh shit! Yeah,
the fact that you went to yellow that. Bookcase and I was like, did he get that from another shelf? And I was like, I would have noticed if it was yellow on yellow. I'm pretty sure it's the first time I'm looking at yellow on yellow.
That's a great point. I didn't even think of that. Because, you know, people sometimes choose blue danger if they know they want to make a move on the blue bookshelf.
Uh-huh.
So I should have thought of that. That's a great idea. Yeah.
Yeah. Let me just explain a little bit. So for the new people in chat, the transfer microfilm mission, there's microfilm in whatever book the spy picks up and decides to transfer. You can either remove that microfilm from the book and then manually pick up another book and put it in and put that book away, or you can just transfer the whole freaking book to another shelf. So he picked up the book at red bookcase and tried to put it away at yellow. That is a behavioral tell because it's something that the AIs are technically capable of doing, but they will never do.
Yeah, there's no individual animation played that's wrong.
Right.
It's just where you put it back.
It's just the AI will never do that. It's something that only the spy will ever do due to the just to complete that mission. So, yeah, I mean, I think I got a little lucky because without that observation, I think it would have been a little screwed. But
I mean, that's a great observation, though, so I should have thought of that.
All right. I will play spy now.
All right.
So what'd you do? You said any... What'd you do?
I think I had 5 of 7.
Okay.
I guess I'll take down the barriers once we have multiple snipers.
Yeah, there you go. That's a good idea.
You need 3 snipers for this map.
Pretty much.
All right, you ready?
Yep.
Off we go. All right. One of each and 2-2-1, I think. That's me memorizing statues for your stream.
I'm going to swap them anyway. I'm not intimidated. Screw you.
No, totally.
Oh, that... I'm what? Sorry. That laser is just too hilarious.
Yeah.
The laser sticking out of the tree. I love it.
I was smiling when I came up with that. So, of course, I had to write a ton of code to make it so the tree was, like, alpha'd on the sniper side, but not on the spy side. Like, it's just
yeah.
total chaos. Like, total chaos. So I think
I love
that
it.
Was always 2-2. Oh, man.
And 3 inspects to... Okay. I wasn't sure it was 2 or yeah. 3. I guess 3 makes more sense.
Maybe I should take it. I should maybe make 4 on this map.
Yeah, it's interesting. Well, I kind of liked that dynamic of making the middle statue more dangerous.
Yeah, I do too. Bondo, move your head. I can't see the statue. That's interesting. There's a lot of occlusion on the statues based on those code conversations. Wow, that's grim.
And the end of red.
Oh, interesting. Uh, there somebody behind? I think this bot. Okay, so I have a note already. I think the sniper needs to be able to move a little bit to the side.
Just oh, you mean a little bit of wiggle room, or?
Yeah, just a little lean. It's just too rigid, because if somebody's behind the pillar, you can't see them at all, depending on which map, which model it is.
Oh, boy.
Hey, where's the guest list? Where's the damn guest list?
I can put it back for you if you'd like.
Yes, please do.
Okay, if you insist.
I think you might be close to done.
Maybe.
Oh, you were Bondo.
I was Bondo. It was so funny because you were like, Bondo, move your head. I thought about moving just to mess with you. But it would have been really funny. Hilarious. No, I love the map so far. I do really like it.
I think a little bit of, how am I going to do lean? Oh, man, that's brutal.
Or you could just tweak the thickness of the dividers.
Yeah, but no, but a person was in the way. Because you can't move at all, you can't get another angle on something, so things can stay blocked.
Uh-huh.
Let's see, I'm making a note here. Hold on a second. When did you purloin, actually? Because I didn't think he was over
near
you.
I did
you.
At the window, actually.
Oh. It was really early, too.
I don't think, well, yeah, maybe it was.
No, 2:32. Not really early, but first half.
Yeah. Yeah, it was in the first half, and I noticed that a lot of people purloin in conversation, like on Courtyard and Ballroom and stuff, I guess, because it's more confusing, or I don't know. But I just did it right at the window. It was risky, but I was also pretty sure you weren't watching me at the time. Because it's funny, because this is a map where you can say with a lot more confidence that, oh, I definitely can't be seen right now.
Yeah, totally, exactly.
Like, baiting isn't going to work nearly as well. Like, in order to bait, you really got to, snap back and forth. But
yeah, which is possible, more so on this map than anywhere else. But, yeah.
All right, let's do a couple more of this, and then I will probably just take a couple questions from the chat to wrap up the interview, unless there are any other topics that you wanted to hit.
Well, I mean, we can always do another interview, too.
Yeah, that's true. It's very true. It's
interviews all the way down.
All right.
Are we trash-talking the whole time now? This map is so crazy, there's no reason not to.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, we couldn't even provide two meaningful commentary on what we're doing exactly. All right. You think you would put some paintings on this?
Yeah, I just didn't have time. Definitely want some paintings. I made the floor and the walls and the pillars different colors just because, you couldn't tell you were rotating.
In the red.
Shit, there is a DA there. Okay.
Oh, that's a bug.
It'd be funny if you said that when you were bugging the ambassador. Oh, yeah, you're right. I'm looking at Plaid right now, and you really can't even...
Yeah, you need a lean.
Yeah.
It's a little lean.
Oh, man. Let's see. Where did he go? Damn it. Wow. Oh, I can't even see if this list is going to disappear or not.
Oh, because he was serving it behind the pillar?
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, that's kind of brutal.
I just low lay a Damon, even though he's totally out of the way.
Yeah, he's like the most out of the way on this map of any other of any map.
Yes.
Second book death.
Yeah.
I thought I was done. What did I only have three? I thought I was like, where's the timer?
One, two. Yeah, I only count three.
No, I have four, but I thought it was four. I needed five.
And you time added. Oof. Man, I'm surprised I didn't notice that. Okay.
I did time add at the beginning. That was lame, but yes. Did you mark the book?
I did not. I marked it like right before you put it away, just so I wouldn't forget. But I do a lot of mental marking these days.
Okay.
Like that's a skill I've refined is mental marking because I guess when I'm a spy, a lot of times I try to figure out whether or not my book's been marked, and that gives me a better idea. So I found that mental marking makes it so that I can make it appear like I didn't bother to mark their book. Or I'll make a note to myself to do it later after the fact. And it was funny because I played a match against Wodar earlier. Was it Wodar? Or was it... No, it wasn't Wodar. Who was it? Who did I play? I played someone earlier, but basically I did not mark their book, but I mentally marked it, and then they threw a banana bread to distract me from them putting the book away. So during the banana bread, I was distracted. I was low-lighting and stuff. And then later I said, oh, I need to mark their book still. So I went to mark it, and the book was gone. So the fact that I didn't, that I made a note to mark it later is actually what alerted me to him having put it away in the wrong shelf, because he was right next to the other bookshelf when I realized it was gone. So
that's perfect.
Really, really funny.
So any 5-7, like, is like, since you're a better player than I am, like, and both all, have we played three so far?
Yeah, we've done
three. All gone your way, so that's good.
Mm-hmm.
That means maybe it's a little bit balanced. Let's see. Let's try it again.
Okay.
Because you should be beating me on balance modes, obviously.
Right, exactly. If this were heavily sniper or heavily spy, then really the role would have more of the win percent rather than the player.
Yeah.
I guess. Any 5-7.
All right, you ready?
Yep.
Our trash talking is pretty not trashy.
Yeah, I know. We're both in like focus, like don't mess up on new map mode.
Yeah.
Your father was a hamster. Your mother smelled of elderberries. Fuck. Okay. The tree sniper. I really hope there's like a lot of like fan art of that or something.
There needs to be rustling as you move around.
Totally.
All right, I may have made a mistake, but we'll see.
Not enough get good scrub, someone said in chat. One v1 me and see what happens. All right.
And the bread.
Interesting. Floating briefcase.
Did you say floating briefcase?
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Just normal sniper bug. I think it's my net being weird.
Mm-hmm. The tree is the sniper, right? Exactly. I really hope there's a lot of, like, fan art of just, like, a sniper rifle laying in a tree or something. I don't know.
I think you had time.
Did I?
I don't know. It's been a long 2 minutes.
I don't know
either. Ugh, I'm way behind on this map. I don't have a plan here. Interesting.
Did you shoot? Okay. Oh, awesome. You.
So what happens is, you added time right as I said that, actually.
Yeah, like right. I didn't even think of doing it until you said that.
So I said it first. So she, I was not playing well. She had a book that I had marked way back, and I didn't think she had gone back over to that bookshelf, but apparently she had. But I thought that was a case of, I thought, because your example with the Wodar game, I thought it would have been funny if that was you and I shot you for the exact same thing you had just talked about.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that would have been really funny. But no. What did I do that was interesting? I returned...
Oh, you did return... You returned the guest list. I did manage to do that.
I was going to say, like, that hasn't seemed too viable on the other maps, and this one, it seems a lot more doable. Yeah. What else did I do that was interesting? I forget. But yeah, the big thing was returning the guest list. Oh, when you highlight my seduction target, look carefully there. First, I contacted Double Agent and got a green, and then I made the seduction target leave early by doing a red test on purpose, and then you highlighted them.
I had them highlight before.
You did?
Didn't I? Where is the highlight for that person? Yeah, way up the top.
Oh, wait. Well, oh, yeah, you're right. I'm sorry. I thought I did something clever, but I didn't.
He was in that conversation made me confirm the highlight, so...
Right.
So you got a book out. What did you do? You just got the blue microphone out. That's all.
Yeah, that's all I did at the very end. I didn't even touch bookshelves until that point.
Yeah. I was like, so basically, I had too much of our chat in my brain because there was that dress with the Wodar example, and blue danger was at the blue bookshelf, and I was like, would he do that just to?
Right.
Like, since we had talked about the color-coded bookshelves.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, you got to get rid of any kind of biases as a spy, or try to get rid of any kind of biases. Or at least be knowledgeable about your opponent's biases. That's, I guess, when you get really good.
That's when you get
into, like, statistics, analytical mode. Mark down every single person shot, try to find a pattern. But
I mean, some people analyze... I mean, like, some of the good players, like, analyze the log a lot more. There's a thread on the...
I look at the log a lot. I like almost after every match for good like 20 seconds or so, I look over the log and see if what was rushed or how passive they played or how close they were to finishing, like all that stuff.
Yeah, totally.
All right.
You bug the ambassador within 5 seconds and 0.8 seconds.
Yeah, exactly.
The game's starting.
All right. So, I mean, we've been going about an hour and a half. Why don't we get to community questions or questions from the chat? We're kind of doing this a little bit different than the last time. Last time I had a thread where people suggested it was a bit more organized. Tonight I wanted to wing it and see how that works. Please, if you have any questions for Chris about Spy Party, about indie game development, about community in games, and really anything, just ask it. Please don't spam your question or I will not get to it. I will choose the ones that I like, and we probably won't get to everyone's questions, obviously, but go ahead and ask. Could Toby ever become a playable character? I like that one.
Yeah. So that's the goal, actually, is to... I mean, there's a lot more ideas than there are time to implement the ideas, but one of the things I wanted to do is both make the security guard, Damon, and Toby be playable characters, which makes some missions easier and some harder, like Poison Drink, obviously, which doesn't exist yet, but eventually would be a lot easier if you're Toby already. Bugging the ambassador may be easier, but but certainly doing bookshelf stuff. So this was actually an interesting thing. I was doing an interview. I have a 10-year-old who's in grade school, obviously, and one of the older kids, like I think it must have been a fifth or sixth grader, a couple years ago, wanted to do an interview with me about video development. And so he and his mom came over, and they set up a little video camera, and he asked me sixth grader reporter questions, and I was explaining the whole if you choose to be the waiter, some missions are easier and some are harder, which is interesting for Yomi. And I was like, for example, putting a book away is really hard. Like, why would the waiter be at the bookshelves? And the woman was like, who doesn't play games or anything, but because this game is about like normal stuff in the real world, she's like, oh, he's cleaning up the glasses. Like, somebody leaves a dirty glass on the bookshelf, so he goes over there. I was like, that's perfect. That's exactly what's going to happen.
Exactly.
So there's so many things like that. So Damon, for the security guard, I want to do a thing where the sniper can ask the security guard to go interview people, and where interview is just like a really simple branching thing that, you know, ask some question, possibly from their dossier, possibly just from a set of generic questions or whatever.
How many drinks did
and
you have
the
tonight?
And the spy can, well, yeah, exactly. The spy can lie and or answer truthfully. Yeah, exactly. That's a good idea of, like, you know, things that have actually happened in the party, so the sniper, that could be a way that both players know about it. But the spy can lie, or the NPC can lie, the spy can lie or not, and whether the NPCs will ever lie or not is the question, right? Then you could be Damon, so now you're getting sniper to go interview people, mm-hmm. and like you bug the ambassador on the way by. Is like, wait, did my security guard just bug the ambassador?
Right.
So like, you can imagine a whole bunch of crazy stuff like that.
Here's an interesting one. I didn't think of this. And with the final version, the final art, how messy is the shot gonna be? If you know what I mean.
Very.
I wasn't sure how you're gonna portray that.
Yeah, there's not gonna be any blood, I don't think. And in fact, I'm gonna put an arrest mode in because my daughter doesn't actually like the sniper shot. It's scary. So, and you know, the game doesn't, like we talked about earlier, the game doesn't change at all.
Right.
Exactly. It changes. It doesn't change mechanically. It does. I think it will actually have an effect on it because aesthetically that matters. And there's an attention release thing that happens, like we talked about. But from a mechanical perspective, it doesn't. So it's going to be an interesting study in how important mechanics are versus the overall, you know, visual and audio aesthetics. But no, it's going to be. It's not going to be a. It's not going to be a. The there's not going to be gore for sure. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, definitely not. Of course. So with the new character art, hang on a second. With the new character art designs, are the characters going to have a lot? When the characters have a lot more detail with which you can identify them, do you think that balance will be skewed a lot by these new character models, or do you think it'll be roughly the same?
No, I think it's going to be all crazy for a little while.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's going to be interesting to see what the we haven't shown what the environments are going to look like yet, and so that's going to change things. Like, it's just going to be a lot more density to the pixels on the screen. You know, it's going to be a lot more. Less iconic in some sense, and so I think it's going to change a lot of stuff. So that's why, for the way we're going to put it in, is that I'm going to put it in on the side. So the goal is to have the new art in by PAX, at least some limping version of art in by PAX, like one level. But it's mm-hmm. going to be bolted on the side, kind of more like a tech demo. I mean, it'll be playable in the sense that, like, you will be able to go in and, you know, contact the double agent and bug the ambassador. There probably won't be drinks. There's not going to be Toby or anything like that. But, right. you know, there'll be just basically a balcony kind of style thing. But it's not going to affect the current game. Like, it'll just be on the side, and until it's actually, you know, tuned and balanced enough, and we've got all the animations and all the maps and everything in, like, it's not going to replace the existing art for a long time, basically, because right. the balance of the game is the most important thing, which is why I released the game basically with this crappy art, because it's all about the gameplay, and the art's going to be awesome, but I don't want it to screw the gameplay up at all.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's see. Yeah, and a lot of people ask this, why banana bread? I mean, I would assume it's just because it's like a common spy trope. You need to have a word that's uncommon enough to be a code word that not anyone would just say it, but it has to be, it can't be ridiculous enough that there'd be a reason for saying it.
Yeah, I mean, that's the fictional motivation that I applied after the fact, which was I was implementing in the mission and was eating a piece of banana bread and needed a code word, and so I said banana bread into my cell phone.
yeah so you it was just right time, right place. It was like the stars aligned, and banana bread
is,
it was.
Yeah, but now the thing is, like, I'm gonna have to keep it banana bread because it's kind of like, you know, internet famous at this point.
Yep, exactly. Or you can buy alternate code words with DLC.
yeah totally. Microtransactions.
Yeah. Let's see. Is this going to be on Mac? I mean, I assume that this is stuff that people could just Google, but...
Yes. Yeah, I mean, so right now, it runs on Wineskin, which is the Mac... So Wineskin is this free, based on Wine, which is a Linux thing, Windows emulator for us. Some apps run with it, like a fair number of apps, but SpyParty run. And so people ported Wine to macOS because macOS is Linux, is a Unix FreeBSD under the hood. And so, and then they made a nice like Mac style wrapper around it. And so basically, like SpyParty basically runs flawlessly on the Mac right now. It's kind of blew me away when someone said that they got it working on there, and then I checked it out on my girlfriend's Mac.
Like, wow.
And like the auto updater works inside. It's just amazing. And so like a ton of beta testers actually use Wineskin. And I'll definitely do a native port at some point, but like I have to say that the awesomeness of Wineskin has like reduced the priority of the native port. Like it runs so amazingly well. I mean, the fact that the auto updater works inside there is just mind boggling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Let's see. Keep the questions coming. These are great. Have you ever thought? Yeah. I mean, tell us a little bit about. I mean, do you have plans for music currently? I assume that you want something timeless like the art, but.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, like I have plans, but I don't have. There will be music. I don't have a plan for what that will be.
Right.
I mean, one crazy idea I had, which I don't know if it's even possible, but like. Is that if the music in the party is played by a band at the party, like in other words, it'll be a little, you know, a little corner where there's like a dude on, you know, like saxophone or something like that. Or, I mean, that'd be so amazing, but man, that's a ton of work. So I don't know if that's even remotely possible, but that kind of like came to mind. That's something that'd be very cool to do.
Yeah. And it's going to be interesting to balance something that, that I guess like kind of like how the visual aesthetics of the new art actually has an impact on the gameplay. The music is something that I don't think will have as much of an impact. So it's going to be interesting to make a choice that's appropriate for the tension that's going on.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you watch people's streams and they're all playing different kinds of music behind the game. And so like, there's just no way to know what people are going to feel like is, you know, the most appropriate thing. So certainly there's got to be a way to mute the music at the very least. You know, are the pieces sized to the length of the time? Is there just, I don't know. I mean, it's something I'm going to figure out at some point, but I basically don't have a clue yet.
Yeah. Someone said the sniper can be a band member. He'll be the drummer or something.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's see.
That would be James Bond, and he throws the drumstick.
I know this is a common one, but I've seen it asked like several times in chat. So as long as you don't mind telling a story you've probably told before, what inspired you to make SpyParty?
Right. So so there's this thing we used to do called the Indie Game Jam, mm-hmm. which we haven't done in a while. But basically, a game jam is where you get a bunch of people together, and over like, you know, a weekend or 4 days, you make games. You know, small game. It's kind of as a break from your main project. And we did them, when we started up the Indie Game Jam, we did it as this like kind of tech theme thing. We'd write an engine and people would come program games with the crazy engine.
Mm-hmm.
So we did like, you know, an engine that did 100,000. The very first year was 100. We asked this idle question. I used to rent an office space with a bunch of other indies. And we were like, oh, I wonder, you know, this is right around the time when 3D graphics hardware was starting out. And we were like, I wonder how many Doom sprite guys these modern 3D cards can render. And it turns out, basically, this was back in like Pentium 5 days or whatever. It was 100,000 Doom sprite guys at 30 frames a second, which is a lot of dudes. You know, like that game, Rome Total War, it was not Rome at the time, but like that's like a couple thousand. So 100,000 is just like a fluid, basically. It's just completely insane. Mm-hmm. So anyway, a guy there did this game called Dueling Machine, which is based on this Ben short story, which basically was he couldn't even use 100,000 guys. He had to use 30,000 guys in a town, like a little city, and you had it was an asymmetric multiplayer game where one person had a single bullet and the other person was running away, and the person with the bullet had a sonar to find the other person in the crowd, and the two character sprites were unique. Mm-hmm. For those two people. And then a few years, a bunch of jams later, indie game jams later, we used to do one a year, so like maybe 4 years later, we were doing a game jam with the Sims assets. And I'd gotten EA to let us use the Sims assets, Sims 1, like all the animations and all the characters. And so we ripped them all out of the Sims and were, you know, going to do basically games about people interacting. And I wanted to do a game. Since I was a host, I was never very good at getting a game done. But I came up with this idea. I was like, I love Dueling Machine so much. And I was like, what's a more intimate version? And so once I had the idea for like a little cocktail party and then a spy and then the reverse Turing test aspect, like the game basically designed itself. But Dueling Machine was kind of the initial thing. I really like the asymmetry, the like hardcore asymmetry. And I took it even farther with SpyParty in the sense that, like, you know, there's not even a movement challenge for the spy or for the sniper, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the things that's different about SpyParty from The Ship or Assassin's Creed Brotherhood in those games, which is just this idea that, like, because it, because of the extreme asymmetry where the sniper never has to watch his back. The spy can't get back at the sniper and backstab him or something like that.
Right.
Which means I can make the tells way more subtle because the sniper is 100% focused on the perception challenge, and the spy is 100% focused on the deception challenge. A game like, you know, Assassin's Creed Brotherhood multiplayer or the ship, you know, there's just this pylon thing where, like, you know, there's, you'll do a little bit of stealthiness, but as soon as you find your target, like, you tend to come out of cloak in order to kill them, mm-hmm. and then the person who was chasing you now knows who you were, and there's just this big pylon effect, and people are running on rooftops and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So by making it just this, by staying true to the complete asymmetry, it allows the game to be way deeper psychologically and behaviorally, which I find really cool.
Uh-huh. Yeah, very cool. Let's see. Gray in chat had a very interesting idea. He said the music can modify how people react to situations. They say if the music changed from really calm to really excited, you can then you could see the party actually get more excited, or, you know, people start
Exactly. I want to do a thing where, like, the sniper has a little bit more control over the flow of the party. So, like, you know, appetizers are served, or even dinner is served, if I can even figure out how to do that.
Oh,
I have no
man.
Idea what that even means. But, like, you know, a buffet with plates, that's just insanity. But,
absolutely.
But you could imagine, like, you know, the music comes down and some people start dancing or things like that. Like, I totally want to experiment with that.
Someone said if the spy is one of the band members, their version of the banana bread could be a wrong note in the song or a bad chord or something.
Totally.
But it would be such a high risk because, well, no, I mean, it wouldn't even work because you'd be able to hear which instrument was wrong. So, I mean, unless you have, like, you know, five trumpet players because it's like a little jazz combo and you have to figure out which trumpet player was the wrong one. But
just a whole parade.
I don't know. Yeah, I mean, someone asked, will the sniper be able to interact with the party itself? Yes, I think you said they'll be able to, like, eventually, or the spy will be able to, like, draw blinds at some point. The sniper will be able to, both guest sides are going to have a lot of tools, right?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, the more you couple them like that, the more it's like there's feedback, and it means that, like, replays, you can't play replays. You can't play against this person in a replay, right? Like, right now, the laser matters a lot, but you could play a game and try and find the spy, but as there's more and more feedback, it becomes harder and harder to do that. But in general, I definitely want there to be a lot of feedback between
the two. This is, I guess, a question I thought of in that sense. Do you ever feel, like, reluctant or, like, apprehensive of, like, really adding in more complex features like that, or are you just looking forward to how it will really enrich in the metagame? Because, I mean, part of the thing that makes this game so great right now is a lot of the simplicity behind it. So how do you feel about that?
Yeah, I mean, I guess how I feel about that is that I feel like I'm onto something, but at the same time, you know, in mathematics, there's this idea of local maxima, right? Like, where, like, you know, imagine a set of hills, and you might be at the top of a hill, but there might be a higher hill a little farther away.
Right.
You have to go downhill to get to that hill, right?
Right.
And so you can't be afraid to go downhill for a little bit. So you just got to be able to break the game. At the same time, like, I feel like the core is there in the sense of, like, not the core meaning all the core features, but, like, we know how the game feels now, and it feels pretty good, and it feels like there's a lot to be done with this version, with this game, you know what I mean?
Right.
The game that we're all playing. And
absolutely.
So things like, you know, there's this question of, like, our dossier is a good idea. Should you have to learn backstory about the people, and then that way when Damon comes and interviews them, that you know, or, like, you know, the general likes to drink too much at the party or things like that. How much of that should be in there? And I don't know. I mean, maybe that's, like, an experiment that goes in, but you could easily imagine that changing the feel of the game. So it's just you just have to be careful. I mean, there's a craft aspect to it and an art aspect, and, like, you know, you just never know with the art aspect. With the craft stuff, you, like, you know, test things and you know, look at the metrics and see how it feels to yourself. But with the art aspect, you just kind of take a leap and, like, you just roll it back if it blows up.
Yeah, I mean, that stuff will also make really good post-release support, because, I mean, that's also a big question, especially for competitive games, is how do you, I guess, keep the flame going once you've released.
Yeah.
A lot of that stuff, I think, would be perfect for that kind of scenario. Here's a good question.
Yeah, totally. You can easily imagine, like, the way, you know, I don't know anybody who does this with multiplayer modes as much, but, like, you know, the way, like, StarCraft campaign mode versus StarCraft online, right? I mean, they're just two totally different games.
Totally.
And so you could imagine the online version of that, where there's, like, the total craziness. Like, I mean, I want to do, like, you know, multiple spies, multiple snipers, all the nonsense that, you know, like, just tons of different options, craziness that way, experiment that way. But you could imagine, like, the tournament mode is like 1v1 what we're playing now. I mean, you could imagine both of those things coexisting.
Here's a map suggestion. I mean, maybe they're competing for the next interview when we put in another map. But
here's all maps are only from Vine Sauce people.
There you go. So Isokeim, however you say your name, he asked if there are any plans for a faster paced map, like one where the guests are running around panicking for whatever reason, or, you know, much harder to follow for the sniper in that regard.
Well, I definitely don't want to make an aim-centric thing where you can't hit somebody. I mean, right now, dancing, like, it's called dancing. Like, right now, if you know you're in countdown and you only need to waste 2 or 3 seconds, like, you can make the sniper miss. The sniper has to shoot somebody else. You can't hit the wall. But, like, and that's, I think that's interesting micro. Like, it's a tiny little dash of micro there that I think is consonant with what the game feels like. Mm-hmm. Making too much micro is—I need to be careful. I want it to be a more macro balanced game than micro. I want the micro to be important. But I thought about things where you're further away, for example. I mean, you have to be careful. Like, I mean, I don't want to do, like, a clock tower, you know, map, because, like, that's just really bad, because that bad shit happened in real life. You know, you want to just kind of stay away from kind of stuff if you can. But you can imagine from a farther zoom and which is kind of equivalent. You know, they're small. Are on screen. If you zoom in, you can sweat less, you know, that sort of thing. I want to play around with a lot of that stuff. I mean, basically any place that people gather or queue up or anything like that is fair game for a map.
Yeah, or even like in the future when you have the arrest mode in, I assume you can, for a map like that, I mean, it's also kind of congruous with just the scenario itself, but if everyone's panicking for some reason, you could also have police on the side and you actually just have the sniper select a portrait for who they want, so that way it takes the aim out and it's... Yep. It matches the theme of everyone panicking like there's a riot and they want to figure out who's responsible. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this is like what we were talking about earlier, where it's just like the game design, the high level game design can accept so many different experiments. It's like, man, there's just like 10 games in here, and this is why I wish more game developers explored just people doing stuff, because I think there's just, I mean, in my findings at least. And it's nice that we have a good framework for it, but in general, like, there's just game design, game play laying all over the floor, as I've said before. Like, it's just like, you know, I added drinks and it's already a mechanic, even though the mission's not even in. It's like, there's just so much stuff if people would just take a risk and do this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's funny that you brought up dancing, because we have an autopilot whenever there's downtime on VineSauce. We have a whole list of videos that play, and one of them is me dancing and then getting Damon shot. That's on our AP. Let's see. I mean, I'm just scrolling up trying to find other good questions. Another funny thing. This isn't really a question, just a funny musing, I guess. But when you eventually, in the long run, put in a mode where the sniper is actually in the party, and it's like a party member. The equivalent of laser pressure is going to be really hilarious. Like, you could imagine this, like the spy is at like a bookshelf, and I just imagine like another character just standing like right next to them, just staring at them. Like, that's the form that laser pressure is going to take when
The sniper is like always this awkward dude who doesn't know how to act at a party.
Yeah, exactly. All right, I'm going to make one last thing for questions. The idle chatter is just, didn't you just like pull that from somewhere? The banter that in the party right now?
Yeah, so it's called Crowdwalla. It's actually the audio engineer the audio designer on Spore gave me this loop, but like it's basically called Crowdwalla, Walla. You can search for it. It's just what sound people call that party sound. And the funny thing is, like, it's amazingly accurate. Like, you go to a cafe and you listen and it sounds like that. But that actually leads to a thing that I want to do audio-wise. I've given more thought into the sound effects than I have about the music. I'm kind of intimidated about the music, actually. But what I would like to do, because actually going to a cafe or a party actually does sound like this, that means that if you're mixing discrete conversations, it becomes Crowdwalla instance, right? Mm-hmm. And so I was thinking, as you zoom in, you have like a parabolic mic or something, and it actually picks up actual conversation, and you have this kind of looping conversation engine that, like, you know, has, you know, people don't really talk about much at parties anyway. Like, it's you know, how's the weather? Oh, yeah, your kid's doing? Yeah. Oh, did you see that band? And you can imagine having that actually do that, and so that they actually, and then weaving actual stuff into the actual audio as a crazy, one of those crazy ideas that might never get explored, but you can imagine it working. And then when you zoom back, it's crowd wallet, but it actually is something, so you train your ear to actually pick up on the real conversations.
Yeah, definitely. Let's see. There's a lot of talk about players trying to act more like an AI. Are you going to try to make... Well, I mean, this is, and we talked about this during the last interview, but it's a delicate balance between whether or not, between trying to make it so that the players can mimic the AI better or trying to make it so that the AI does more player-like behaviors. Which one do you spend more time on these days?
A good example of that right now is pathing. I'm expecting to have to spend a month or so on pathing at some point where I just totally rewrite them thing and make it a little less, basically split the difference again. It needs to be predictable so that player can emulate it, but at the same time it's just too janky right now, like, you know, just all these little tiny things that the AIs do that people who are pathing aficionados like R7 Stewart, who's one of the top players, like, can just, like, it's on how you're moving, and like that's it's a little bit too mechanistic right now, so yeah, it's a delicate balance. And the nice thing about the game design is that you can always just throw your hands in the air and make the player act like the NPCs if you can't figure out how to make the NPCs act like the player. But I do try and balance between the two.
Gotcha. Absolutely. All right. A lot of the questions now are saying, you should do this map, you should do that. Like, a lot of suggestions like that. I'm going to say, if you are legitimately excited about the design of this game, because it's a very exciting game, if you are legitimately excited that you want to suggest that kind of stuff, you should just pick up the game, because if you like thinking about how the map changes, how new maps can really impact the design of the game, if you like to ponder those types of things, you will like the game, and you should just pick up the game.
Yeah, and the community is really great about the I mean, it's just the forum. A lot of the ideas in the game come from the community. Like, there's a forum. I tend to bias towards the actual beta forum because those people have experience with the game and stuff like that for taking ideas and stuff. But I'm open to all ideas. I mean, like I said, the this map that we were just playing came from Vinesauce chat, you know, 6 months ago or whenever we did that. But yeah, there's a really active part of the beta forums, which is suggestions. There's like 5 different suggestions threads. There's general suggestions, new mission types, new map types, new game modes, alternate crazy game modes with the current rules, like all kinds of cool stuff. So I mean, there's definitely like, I mean, how many pages is the suggestion thread at this point?
It's
like 100 like, something?
Yeah, it's immense.
Nigh infinite.
And I gotta say, I mean, I imagine there are a lot of developers like this, and I've only been in a handful of betas, but I'm super impressed by how you read literally every single topic and every single post in that forum. It's crazy and awesome.
Yeah, well, I try. I mean, it's kind of good. It's good that the forum's a little bit secret right now in the sense that, like, not everybody in the beta knows about the forum. So that probably makes it a little more possible for me to do that. But also, it's just the quality of the posts is just amazing. It's so great. People are really good about reporting bugs. They're really good about giving suggestions. They're really good about, I mean, we've got this crew of people who like find dupes and stuff like that, and like, it's just awesome. I'm just so happy
you have the best.
I'm so happy that
beta
it like
players.
Survived.
Like you said in Twitter earlier, you have the best beta players.
Yeah,
even if they will pull some mean April Fool's bugs.
Yeah, that's
on you.
I was just particularly fragile that day, and then all those fake bug reports came in, and I couldn't tell which ones were the bug ones or not. I was like, no. I was like, someone please fix this.
Oh man, yeah. But yeah, it's pretty amazing. I mean, the map I'm hoping gets in next. I'm just gonna throw this out there just for you to stew
totally.
On. But the map I'm hoping comes gets messed with next is random generation map, like Spelunky. Remember?
Oh, man. Yeah.
I'm really hoping for that because I'm huge about random generation in gameplay.
I doubt that'll be next, just because that code as opposed to geometry.
Right.
Like,
that's like
I
brand new code,
day,
pretty
right?
much. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And this is
But I definitely want to do it. And I also, on that topic, I mean, the same engine, quote unquote, the same code that would make that work would open it up to mods too, right? Like, once you've parameterized everything and it's not just hard coded in the Maya file, then, like, I mean, just imagine the player created maps with the way the modern way to do that kind of stuff is so great, where you, like, you know, I host them and then it auto downloads if people agree on a thing. Well, you know, once been vetted by, you know, people to make sure it's not going to crash anything or something like that.
Right.
Like, just so great. Like, all of these, like, always connected, like, you know, things are you know, living on S3, so everyone gets fast download speeds to it. And then, like, you know, like I want to do with the replays, like once I get Spectation and replays in, I want it to just archive every game ever played up to the cloud. And like all of a sudden there's a replay server and you can just go watch any game. Like you want to see like KCM and R7 play the tournament games or whatever, like you can go watch all the games and see them from all sides and see what's going on.
Yeah, definitely.
And for a competitive game, that's just great.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. Well,
it's an insane amount of work to make a game nowadays because the expectations for that stuff are just so high.
Oh yeah,
right. It's when you get it working, it's great. I mean, expectation and replays and like a mod database and all that kind of stuff is just. I mean, the stuff that comes out of that is just so cool when it works.
Mm-hmm. Totally. All right. Well, we're nearing the 2 hour mark. You want to do a couple more?
Sure. Couple balconies and be done.
Yeah, sure. Let's do that. You want to do balcony?
Yeah.
All right, so we're just going to end.
A2 is back, but we should play A2 of 4 because it's more fun.
Okay, that's fine. So we're just going to wrap up with a couple quick rounds of balcony. Good old arcade mood. No, I'm not bored at all. I'm just sleepy a little bit. But no, I'm having a great time, and I hope that you're enjoying being a guest on our stream. I mean, you're always welcome.
Totally, yeah. It's always a great time. I apologize that I can't watch the stream chat.
It's okay. Yeah, like I said, I mean they're really slow tonight. I mean they've been very well behaved. I've been impressed. But yeah, maybe another time.
I sometimes stop by when you're streaming with somebody else in chat. Then I can pay full attention to the chat and not the stream. But if I'm live on the stream, I wouldn't be able to talk.
Mm-hmm. All right. All
right.
Yeah, let's do it. And go.
We're trash talking, right?
Oh yeah, absolutely. You suck. Figured you out already. Terrible. You're about to purloin that guest list. There it goes. Oh, never mind. I'm really surprised you haven't banana breaded. And shoot.
Oh, see, there we're talking to the pathing.
Yeah. I mean, and that's what I was trying to talk about when you actually did get away with purloin earlier, but that's a good example of one of the very small subtleties that a more experienced player can catch. In this case, yeah, he had a dead stop at one point. It was very small, but it was enough to get caught.
You need to hit the strafe key so fast to get those. I still need to practice at it. I mean, that's my new thing that I want to do now that the beta's open is do this like streaming show where I basically get schooled and mentored by all of you more elite players, and so that'll be great. So you can be a guest on that show as well and give me the actual mentoring.
Yeah, someone said, watch out for that planet. It might have another sniper in it. I could just imagine like a tiny little laser coming out of the planet. That could be an interesting angle on balcony, though. I mean, you got to think about
totally.
That.
Totally.
Little.
It'd be impossible to see the guest list at that point.
I mean, you do need little people. I guess I should put it, if I want to be politically correct, you need them on the roster too.
Totally.
So that could be the sniper representative on this map. But anyway. All right, spy. But yeah, if I was being less serious, I probably would have waited to shoot there and like until like, he was. Done something more incriminating, but
you mean more serious or less serious,
or more? Wait, something more serious. Like if you had like done a hard tell or just some more suspicion. But the fact I just felt like
right.
shooting because okay. I figured it'd be badass if I did succeed. So
it's good. You looked good on the stream. That's for sure.
Yeah.
Are you ready?
Yep.
Let's see if you can go 2-0 here. Live on your streamer if I can shoot you right before we log off in the end of red. Is the game going to end in 2 seconds?
No. About 3.
Ah! Nice. Oh, you got the guest list. Damn.
I did. I did the banana bread when it got swapped.
I was panicking about whether you had bugged like the previous game. Nice. 2-0 on your stream, making you look good.
Yeah. But no, I'm really looking forward to seeing your stream your, because like he just said, he Checker's going to soon, or Chris is soon going to be doing his own stream, his own weekly stream of Spy Party, and kind of learn how to get really, really good at your own game.
Yeah, well, I'm really looking forward to that. I mean, I need to practice more for sure.
I'm interested in seeing how that's going to change, I guess, the balancing philosophies or some of the choices in the design once you start to, I guess, be more inside that high level play.
Right. I mean, it's like once I slipped out of the highest level play, like I'm making decisions kind of based on intuition, but you want to basically that's like the art versus this craft thing. And I'm losing on the craft side at this point. So I need to get back into it. Mm-hmm. I asked Rob Pardo, the chief game designer guy of Blizzard, about how much the StarCraft tuning designers play. And he's like 3 or 4 hours a day, which, wow. Oh my God. Yeah.
Well, that's I guess if that's your job, just tuning, I mean, there's no better way to do it.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So I can't do 2 or 3 hours. I can't do 3 or 4 hours a day, but like probably an hour a day I'm going to have to start doing, or else it's just going to get away from me.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. Well, I think that about wraps it up. I mean, it was great to have you by. I know I said this earlier, but you're welcome anytime at all. I know there are probably some members of Vinesauce that are sick of me doing Spy Party all the time, so I'm probably going to take a streaming sabbatical from Spy Party, but I'm definitely not done with it entirely. I'm going to come back to it, especially when there's updates and things like that.
Awesome.
Do you have anything that you wanted to put forward to the chat? I mean, everyone buy this game. If enough people get it, I'm going to do a Vine Cup. I'm going to do a Vine Cup tournament just for Vine Saucers if enough people pick it up. But do you have anything that you want to say?
No, I mean, I just think, you guys are awesome, and the welcoming community is so great. Like I just really appreciate all the love the game has gotten from you guys. It's really cool, and the ideas too, like I said, there's the Panopticon, so the payoff is there.
Yeah, and so far my impressions of that map, I love it. I think it's great. Yeah, I love that it's starting to creep into the side of things where the, like, having the leaves make the sniper's view a bit more busy. I like that it's starting to get into that side of things too. Instead of just like weird. The pure design side of thing, but all right, I guess that's it. So thanks, Chris. Thanks for coming by, and I'll catch you next time. I really look forward to the future Spy Party. Yeah, I'll see you in the lobby.
Anybody who ends up joining, say hi in the lobby.
Yeah, definitely. All right, see you later.
Thanks.